Right, here we go. Okay, so I am in Dunk Canyon right now. This is going to be a great flat surface for me to start with. And I'm going to start by placing down this Utropia Sawblade that's in my hotbar right now. Now, I'm cheating a little bit as this is a stamp that I have made, but I think this is going to be a great example as to how you can modify and change stamps placed down to best suit your goals. So as you can see here, this stamp is ungroupable. See, this button has been disabled, and that means you cannot break it apart. So with other groups, you can break that group apart and they won't be connected as a whole, but in this one, it is not available. The creator of the stamp, that's me, has not allowed users to do that. This doesn't mean that I can't change any of this. It may look like it right now, but that doesn't. We have a few ways that we can change this and modify this stamp to best suit our goals. The first way I'm going to show that to you is with group editing mode. So as you can see, there's this button here next to the attributes label, and this will enter us into a state where everything has been grayed out. I cannot select anything else about this level except for individual elements of this stamp. This is going to be really useful as now we can take a look at this stamp and really understand how it works. So this is going to be the first thing that you want to do when you place down a stamp, especially a logic stamp like this. Ones with lots of logic nodes like this, it can be a bit confusing at first to work out what's going on. But let me tell you some little tricks that I've learned to help better understand how stamps function. So the first way to work out how a stamp works is to just think through it, really. So what we have is a saw blade. We know that this is probably a blade that spins like this in the game, and it will give damage to the player. That makes sense. So what we can look for first is this rotate node. So a rotate node will rotate this asset. It will rotate it 360 degrees every 0.4 seconds. So that's a pretty quick rotation that it's going to do that. Also, I can see here as well that there is a damage volume. I'm going to say that again because I pronounced that really weird. You can also see that there's a damage volume here. So this damage volume will give out 50 damage per second, only on players, not vehicles. So that's all right. If we were making a race, or we are making an arc that involves vehicles and we want vehicles to be damaged, we can just tick this right here. Exit group editing mode, and that will now affect vehicles well. What I'm also noting in this stamp, which will become evident in my second thing that I suggest, is to actually play the arc and see how the stamp works on its own. You can see that the stamp doesn't actually rotate, so it is not giving me damage, so it starts in an off state. So I want for my arc for this sawblade to start rotating, start spinning as soon as it begins. I think that would work best for me right now. So how do we best do this? Taking a look at all the different logics and taking a look at where these arrows lead, I can see that when this trigger node is fired, it stops playing the sound but moving. It also is connected to a bunch of gates. We don't have to worry about what these are. These are probably just checkers to make sure the stamp doesn't break. So what I'm guessing is that this trigger node here, a trigger node is essentially, you can link a whole bunch of nodes to it, and it sort of starts, it acts as a route. So you can put one thing in here and it will trigger all of these things. It saves some time for the stamp creator. So what we'll do, I think we'll be all right with that. So I think how this stamp works is that when you start this trigger node, it will activate all these gates that will start rotating. It will enable damage volume, I think. Yep, you can see it there. And then this one, which is slightly lower than this other trigger node, turns it off, as you can see, stops that audio there. So it can be a little bit confusing at times to work out what's going on, but if you're ever confused, we have the Discord. You can always ask questions in. Maybe the creator of the stamp is in the Discord and can help you out. So I want this sawblade to start moving as soon as the arc begins. So what I can do is I can type start here, and I'll find the on start node, which triggers when an arc loads in. That's what I want. But I need this to actually be a part of this stamp. However, as you can see, when I click on it, I can't actually control all the elements of it because I'm outside of group editing mode right now. What we can do is we can incorporate this start node into the stamp. We can make it a part of the stamp itself. So I'm gonna go into editing group mode, and I'm gonna click this add button here. Now what this will do is that it will look out towards the grayed out areas, right? It will look out and I am able to select parts that are outside of the stamp. So I can click on this on start node here. And then if I confirm that selection, I can click on multiple things. I can bring the whole of the Dunk Canyon into it, this stamp if I want, but right now I just want this on start node. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna click on it and I'm gonna confirm my selection. And as you can see, it's lit up a little bit more there. And so that means that it is now part of this stamp. And so I can now click both of those on start, activate. And now if I enter play mode for it to load, it now starts immediately, like so. Probably hear it spinning now. Also, you can see it causes damage, exactly what we want. So that's how you can add things into your stamp in order to change it or modify it. If we want to do something different, we can of course remove this as well. Similar to add, just remove. You can't select anything outside of it because we want to choose what inside of the stamp we want to remove. So we just click on that, confirm the selection, and now as you can see, exit. This is now separate, but the stamp remains the same. You can also see that it still remains connected. We can talk about how to connect things and logic later on. So what I'm thinking is I want to be able to enter an area of the map or activate a pressure plate that will cause this sawblade to spin. So I don't want it to start on the beginning, so I can delete that. And if I find a pressure plate, type it in the search, I can find a generic pressure plate here. That's not going to be the one we want. This is a static prop. What we want, I believe, is one of these. This one here. As you can see, it's got all these bunch of nodes. It's got a lot of attributes on it. This one's not a static prop. This one is actually interactable. I'm going to place this on. Yep. So what I want to activate sawblade. However, I don't really want to add pressure plates into this stamp right now. Many different reasons. If say I've got two sawblades, I'm gonna separate those. I don't want to create two pressure plates and overlap them. That's just going to be messy. I want this one pressure plate to activate both saw blades. So instead of going into group edit mode and changing and adding this into each stamp, I'm going to change my selection mode. And how you can do that is you can press the full stop key on your keyboard. And you can see that little head up right there that says selection mode subgroup. But if we press it again, it changes it to individual. And now you can see instead of selecting the entire group, it's selecting each individual part for everything, including world here. So that's going to be really useful. That means that now we can select this pressure plate and select these start nodes. We can activate it, each floor blade. So, not if I play mode from here. And now off, when I hop onto this pressure plate, both turn on and create quite a noise. So that's a quicker way for you to connect logic up to stamps, and that's a quick way of modifying stamps as well. Even if you cannot ungroup them, you can edit them via group editing modes. So, or you can change your selection mode by pressing the full stop key on your keyboard. You select each asset individually and change the logic like so. But let's do this again for a different stamp this time. I want something a little bit more visual. I want to make this area feel a little bit more lived in. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go into our public stamps, and we've got all the stamps our community has made. I want to find specifically this church. Now this church has come from the Unctropia level, and someone has separated it out for us. It separately stamps. Here it is, it's got description, and we can place it down flush with the floor there. Now this is great on its own, but I do want players to enter, to be able to enter and exit this building. And as you can see, the door is currently closed and it's not an interactable door. So like before, I can enter group editing mode. Click that, select this door, and I can just rotate that open. I'm not interested making it interactable. I just want it open now. There we go. You can see if I turn the torch on, it's a little bit blocked off. You can tell that the church was supposed to be sort of barricaded, lived in. So I'm going to delete for now. So as you can see now, that is enterable, but it is quite dark. So what I want to do is I want to go into the effects, lights, and I'm just gonna put a quick point light down. Not gonna look very good, but for the purposes of what we need, it's going to work really well. So increase the range here, just matches everything. I'm just gonna turn that brightness up as well, just to make sure everything's visible. And I do actually want to make this a part of this stamp for my arc, so that if I want to make more churches in the area, or I want to duplicate this around, it just makes it easier. I don't have to click on the church, then everything inside it that I've modified. So again, group editing, add, click on the light, and confirm that selection. And now click on all of this, as you can see, point light comes with. So let's make this room a little bit more lived in, shall we? I'm gonna find some stamps on that the community has made. I'm pretty sure that someone made double bed. There we go. So I'm going to add this to the arc. place it in there. That looks all right for what we need. Just to give it a bit more life, let's rotate this in. If I wanted to change this, of course, I can go into group editing mode and part of this as well. So that works quite well for what we need. Find some tables. Nothing too fancy. That was probably a bit too fancy, but it'll do for what we need. And some chairs as well. Feeling that whoever owns this building has spent a little bit more on furniture than renovating the place, but there we go. Now, if I wanted to duplicate this church, move it around, have this be a lot of buildings in maybe a large city area or something like that, I can group editing, press add, and I can bring in all these as well. So there we go. Now I can hit these. This front asset won't come with me because that is separate set now from the group. Rotate this in. I can see there's a little bit of a gap at the front from what we did. That should be a quick fix. And now we can play this. And we have two identical churches. Again, nothing too fancy. I just wanted to show you guys how we can modify stamps to suit what we need. So before, this was a church that we couldn't open, and using group editing modes, we can now actually change things around, modify things, all without needing to ungroup the stamp in its entirety. So I hope this helped. I hope with this video that you learned how you can change stamps, how you can modify them to suit your needs, and I hope that you're able to create engaging and fun arcs all through the power of stamps. There is so much potential that you can do with them. I'm super excited to see what you all make. So thank you for watching.